Does anybody believe in a miracle working God? You know that our God can do anything but fail. We need to trust in a miracle working God. Good morning and welcome to the church at EPFM. That's right, East Point First, Malibu United Methodist Church. I'm Michael Stinson and I'm proud to serve as the pastor of this wonderful congregation. As you know, because of the way things are today, we have to worship virtually. So we're not in our sanctuary, but we can still be together because the Spirit of God is everywhere. He is omnipresent and He's with me here, but He's also with you. I want to thank you for coming out this Sunday. I want to especially thank our guests and our friends who are not members of East Point First Malibu for coming out and sharing with us. You know, last week we had people from California, from Chicago, from New York, from Philadelphia. We are reaching people that we never reached before when we were inside the four walls of the church. And you know, that's what we're supposed to be. It's not about those four walls, because we are the body of Christ. Right now, we will not be back probably until July, back into our sanctuaries. We will continue to meet here like this. You know, it's interesting. I understand that the president said that we should go back into our churches so that we can pray. As if we don't pray all the time, as we need to go to church to pray. We can pray wherever we are, and we can pray together from wherever we are, whether it's over the phone, or whether it's live like this, or even if it's just in your own bedroom, as you drive along the streets, prayer does not stop because the building is closed. Remember, the church is not closed down, just the building. We were called to be the body of the church, the body of Christ. We were not called to be a building. So we thank you for coming and celebrating with us this day. Our office is open virtually on Tuesdays through Thursdays from 10 a.m. to 2:30 p.m. That's 10 a.m. to 2:30 p.m. Calls and emails will be responded to during that time period. But we still have a lot going on at the church. Now, next Tuesday, the 2nd of June, the Tuesday evening Bible study will resume at 6:30. This week, we will continue to have our Wednesday noon and 5:30 Bible studies. Done by Zoom. If you need more information on that, you can contact the church office and get that information. You can also go to our EPFM webpage and watch it there. Take a look at it there. As you know, I have started doing this Facebook Live on my own page, but now since we have our new Facebook page for the church, we're actually streaming live from our own webpage, from our own Facebook page, EPFM. Space UMC. That's EPFM space UMC. So a lot of people are coming to my page to look for it. Don't look for it there. Let's go to the church's Facebook page and let's look there. I hope you enjoy the Facebook page. It has been refreshed and uplifted. But not only do we have a new Facebook page, we have a new YouTube channel. That's right. We have a new YouTube channel. So if you missed the sermon series, Journey to the Cross is there. This sermon series is there. All you have to do is just go online and pull it up. And you can also share this with your friends and share that with your friends. We need to get this good word out. So we just thank you for being here. Now, we also have our Thirsty Thursdays where we gather together for prayer from 12 to 12:30. After a hump day, after you finally get past that Wednesday, you might feel a little tired and trying to get through Friday, you might just need a little word of encouragement. And that's what Thirsty Thursdays is for. We want to fill your spirit with the living word of God through prayer. If you would like to participate, you can give us a call at 425-436-6327. That's 425-436-6327. And the code is 171188. 171188, of course, and then the pound sign. Now, we are still worshiping. We are still working at the church, giving away food on Tuesdays and Thursdays. We've been giving away about 7,000 pounds of food a week. That's right, 7,000 pounds of food a week. We thought it was going to end in May, but it's now been extended through the end of June. So if you would like to participate, to be a volunteer servant, then you can come out on Tuesdays at 12:30 or Wednesdays or Thursdays at 11:30. That's Tuesdays at 12:30 or Thursdays at 11:30 so that you can help us get things together so that we can continue to serve our community. If you would like, our main way of reaching the people of the church is through emails and through phone calls. So if we don't have your information, please call the church office to give us your information. If you're not a member but you want to be included on our weekly e-blast, please give the call to the church, or you can send an email to the church. The email address is office@epfmumc.org, office@epfmumc.org, or you can call the church at 404-761-3183. That's 404-761-3183. And of course, if you need pastoral care, you can call me directly at 404-579-5277. That's 404-579-5277. You know, with the great work we're doing, we still need your assistance to help us to do it. The church, because we are not gathering in the church, the lights still need to be kept on, the air conditioning still needs to be going, and we're preparing to, what we need to do to come back in the church. So your tithes and your offerings are greatly appreciated. And you don't have to be a member to give. Now, we have five ways that you can give. You can give online at epfmumc.org. That's epfmumc.org. You can also text to give at 404-567-5052. That's 404-567-5052. You can give through the Give Plus app. You can mail a check to the church directly at 2651 Church Street. That's 2651 Church Street, East Point, Georgia, 30344. Or you can drive by the church and use the mail slot with which to drop your check or your cash in the mail slot. It is secure. Now, we ask that you continue to pray for our members. This is Memorial Day weekend, and it's a day that we stop and pause and reflect on those who've given their lives to make this country what it is today. Those who made the ultimate sacrifice for us that we may have liberty and freedom. So if you have lost a loved one because of a war for this country, we thank you for your sacrifice. And let's just say a brief prayer for our fallen heroes. Well, Lord our God, we thank you for this day. We thank you for this great country of ours. For Lord, we know that you have placed us here for a reason. We thank you for those, Lord, who have served and have given the ultimate sacrifice that we may have freedom and liberty. Now, Lord, we ask that you bless those families, that you comfort those who grieve. But Lord, we just thank you for the witness of those who deemed it not robbery to give themselves for us. We thank you. We love you. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Now we ask that you can continue to keep our church in prayer. Pray for those who are sick. Pray for those who are fighting COVID-19. We ask that you pray for those that they may not get COVID-19. We just thank you for your prayers for all that you can and all that you do. I want to especially thank you for your prayers last week. As you know, I was on a spiritual enrichment, and I asked you to pray for me every day at noon. And believe me, I felt your prayers. And I want to thank you for during that time I was able to finished one book, read three others from cover to cover, and started on a fifth. So I have been blessed and enriched, and you'll hear more as we get back to the church. Now, as you know, we are in the middle of a sermon series. Well, actually, we're at the end of a sermon series called The Resurrection, Now What? The Resurrection, Now What? Jesus has been crucified after his 3 years of ministry. He has been placed in a borrowed tomb, but on the third day, the tomb was empty. And then he appears to his disciples and lets them know that the resurrection is real. Now what? What did it do for the disciples, that first century followers of Jesus? How did this help them to live their life? How does it inform and help us even in the 21st century? So we started out with overcoming grief and fear. When Jesus first appeared to his disciples, they were behind locked doors. They were grieving his death, but they were also fearful of what the authorities might do to them. But through the power of the resurrection, they were able to overcome their grief
and overcome their fear, and we can do the same thing because of the resurrection. Then we went to thriving, not surviving. Thriving, not surviving. At times like these, at times of distress, of hurricanes, earthquakes, COVID-19, it's time for Christians to come together to be the church. Paul says we are supposed to shine like stars in this crooked and perverse generation. We're not supposed to put our heads under the pillows and wait for it to go away. This is the time for the church to be the church. So we need to thrive and not just survive. Then we went to never alone, because Jesus has now died. He has sent the Holy Spirit to not only be with us, but to be in us. You see, throughout the Bible, God says, I will never leave you nor forsake you. But now he's even taking it a step further by putting the Holy Spirit inside you. So you're never alone, even though you may be isolated, even though there's no one else in your house. Jesus is with you. The Holy Spirit is with you. So we are never alone. Then we talked about the power of prayer, and specifically a mother's prayer. It's the only place in the Bible where we saw Jesus losing an argument, and was to a woman fighting for her baby. And you see, there's power in the persistence of a mother fighting for her baby, and we need to pray just like that. My Bible tells me that the effectual, fervent prayer of the righteous availeth much. So we need to pray like that woman when it comes time to express our needs to God. And then last week we talked about true faith. If we want to continue to be the body of Christ and to live like Christians, we have to have a faith. And our faith is based on Jesus' resurrection. Because he got up, because he lives, then we can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all hope is, we have all hope with us now. So we have to have that true faith, even though we can't see the end, even though we don't understand, we need to continue to have faith in the Lord our God. So that brings us to today, and today, according to the Christian calendar, is Ascension Sunday. Ascension Sunday. This is the last time that the disciples get a chance to see Jesus. Isn't it interesting that sermon series started with the first time they saw Jesus after the resurrection, and now we end it with the last time they see Jesus before he goes into heaven. So our scripture, it comes from the book of Acts, chapter 1, verses 1 through 9. That's Acts chapter 1, verses 1 through 9. Here, the words penned by Luke, the physician. It says, in the first book, Theophilus, I wrote all about that Jesus did and taught from the beginning until the day when he was taken up to heaven, after giving instructions through the Holy Spirit to the apostles whom he had chosen. After his suffering, he presented himself alive to them by many convincing proofs, appearing to them during 40 days and speaking about the kingdom of God. While staying with them, he ordered them not to leave Jerusalem, but to wait there for the promise of the Father. This, he said, is what you heard from me. For John baptized with water, but you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit not many days from now. So when they had come together, they asked him, Lord, is this the time when you will restore the kingdom to Israel? He replied, it is not for you to know the times or the periods that the Father has set by his own authority. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you. And you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, in all Judea, and Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. When he had said this, as they were watching, he was lifted up, and the cloud took him out of their sight. This is the word of God. For us, the people of God, thanks be to God. I find it interesting that the last time that the disciples see Jesus, he gives them one more task to do. He says that when the Holy Spirit comes upon you, you will be my witnesses. That's right. That's the last thing he told the disciples, that you will be my witnesses. So I came here today just to ask you one question. Can I get a witness? Can I get a witness? Won't you pray with me? Oh Lord our God, we thank you for this day. We thank you for this time of worship. We thank you that no matter what the enemy throws against us, no matter what obstacles are placed in our way, that we can still gather together as the body of Christ. That we can still worship you and praise you in spirit and in truth wherever we are. Lord, we ask blessings on those who have died from this disease, blessing on those who are fighting for their lives because of this disease. We ask blessings on the frontline workers who are trying to keep us safe. We ask blessings, O Lord, on those who sleep under bridges. We ask blessings, O Lord, on those who are in the nursing homes. We ask blessings, O Lord, on each and every one of us because we all need you. Now, Lord, open our ears, open our minds, open our hearts and our souls so we might hear a word from you, Lord. Now minimize your preacher and maximize your spirit within, that the words of my mouth and the meditation of all of our hearts may be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our strength and our redeemer. And the children of God said, amen.
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 And amen.
Amen.
Now, I asked you one question already, can I get a witness? But I want you to know there's going to be a lot more questions asked today. So if you don't have your pad and your pencil and your paper and your ink pen, you need to get it now, or have your iPad so you can type into it, because this is not going to be a quick sermon that you can remember everything that I said. This is not going to be something simple. I'm giving you meat today, because we need meat sometimes. We can't always go by getting some milk. Sometimes we need meat. And so today is going to be a little bit different. You see, Jesus says that we are also supposed to love God with all of our minds. That's right, love God with our minds. And the only way we can ask love God with our minds is if we consider what we're actually doing. You see, God gave us a mind so that we can choose to follow him or not. It's a conscious decision. So we need to ask some questions today to see where you are in your Christian walk and to see where you're going. Can I get a witness? The first question is this. What is the why of the church? What is the why of the church? Why do we do what we do? Some people say, well, we do it so that we can feed the hungry or we can clothe the naked. No, that's something that comes from our why. Now, I'm going to give you three whys that I see in the scripture, and I call these three whys because these are three things that Jesus specifically told us to do. The first thing he told us is to make disciples. To make disciples. That's our first why. In Matthew 28 chapter, verses 19 to 20, Jesus says, therefore, go into all nations and make disciples, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and of the Holy Ghost, and teach them everything that I have commanded of you. He told us to go and make disciples. So that's one why. The second why is to love. To love. Jesus last night here on earth before he was taken captive, he told his disciples in John 13, 34, a new commandment that I give you, that you love one another as I have loved you. But then he goes on a little bit further in verse 35 and says, by this they will know you're my disciples for your love for one another. So people are supposed to recognize that we are Christians by the love that we give. So we are definitely supposed to love. So we should make disciples, we are to love, and finally, we are to witness. That's what it says in verse 8. We are to be his witnesses. Now, to understand what a witness tells you what they have seen, what they have heard, or what they have experienced. What they have seen, what they have heard, or what they have experienced. You see, evangelism has gotten a bad rap because of televangelists. They get up there and want to make sure you give them your money. It's gotten a bad rap because of what they call the evangelical Christians, even evangelical Christians that preach anything but love. And it's given a bad rap by the street evangelist that gets on a soapbox on a corner and says, if you don't believe like I believe, you're going to hell. So people don't want to evangelize, but Jesus says that we are to be his witnesses. And what are we to witness to? The gospel. You know, the gospel literally means the good news. And if it's the good news, why don't we want to share it? Remember, a witness tells what they have seen, what they have heard, or what they have experienced. So this is my second question to you. What's your personal why? What's your why? Why are you a Christian? You don't have to be. You could be a Muslim. You could be a Hindu. You could be a Buddhist. You could be an atheist. But why are you a Christian? Do you know why? Why do you go to church? Is it because I always go to church going up on Sundays? This is what I do on Sundays? Do you go to church because this is the only time of the week I get to see my friends? Do you go to church because I'm an usher? I go to church because I sing in the choir. I go to church because I'm a Sunday school teacher. What's your why? Until you determine what your why is in this thing called Christ, you can't change your behaviors and you can't do what God is calling you to do. What is your why? Now, I'm going to give you two. Let's look through the scriptures as we read what happened in the books of Acts. So in verse 3, it tells us that Jesus was there for 40 days with many proofs. Jesus started his ministry with 40 days in the wilderness. He ends his ministry with 40 days walking around proving that he is alive. Paul tells us later that he showed himself to 500 people. Then in verse 4 and 5, Jesus tells them to wait here because John baptized with water, but you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit. And it's important to be baptized with the Holy Spirit because that's where we get our power from. But look at this. After Jesus tells them they're going to get baptized by the Holy Spirit, you know their next question? Are you going to restore the kingdom of Israel now? You see, Israel was under occupation by Rome. And they wanted a Messiah that was along the lines of David, a warrior king who would come and take off the shells, the shackles of oppression and restore them as the leading dominant figure or country in that region. But that wasn't the kind of Messiah that Jesus was. And hear how Jesus responded to them. That's not for you to know. Don't worry about the time. Don't worry about when the kingdom is coming.
Right.
But let me tell you what you do need to know. But you will be my witnesses. That's right. You will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, in Judea, in Samaria, and to all the earth. Now, some people say this is a concentric circle going out and out, and that's not how it actually works. You see, Jerusalem was actually in Judea, true, but Samaria was the next town over, and then to the ends of the world. But that's not just a pattern of how to go out. You see, Jerusalem was where the most pious Jews were. They were the ones who made sure they were following the law. They were the ones who were always in the temple. But then you go to Judea, they were also Jewish people, but they were not as strict in their faith. Then you have the Samaritans, which were half-breeds, half Jews and half other stuff. And then you have the end of the world, which are the Gentiles. So Jesus is giving them a mission to start with the people who are like you, but then go out to the people who are similar to you, and then to the people who are not like you at all. So he went from the Jews to the half-breeds to the Gentiles, which tells me the church was originally meant to be multi-ethnic and multicultural. You see, we're not supposed to be an all-black church or an all-white church or an all-Hispanic church. Heaven's not going to look like that. Why do our churches look like that? We need to have all people coming together because that's what God intends for us.
Preach.
So, why witness? Why witness? I'm going to give you three things why you need to witness. I told you you need your pen and paper. First reason to witness is because he told us to. It's just that simple. He said, do it. We need to do it. Now, when I was growing up, if you were in my era, when your mama told you to do something, you might ask why once. You might ask why twice. But before you got ready to ask why a third time, she would just say, because I told you to. Because I told you to. You see, sometimes we just need to do what God tells us to do. As a matter of fact, Peter responded to this as well. In 1 Peter 3:15, he says, always be ready to make your defense to anyone who demands for you an accounting for the hope that is in you. You see, if you have a hope in Jesus, somebody's going to want to know why. Can you tell them why you got hope? If you can't tell them why you have a hope, then you've just got an empty hope. And you're really not hoping it on anything. You're supposed to have a defense for anyone who demands for you an accounting for the hope that is within you. And here it comes after this. I think this is quite interesting that Peter, the rambunctious one, would even say this. He says, yet, do it with gentleness and reverence. Peter is the one who acts off an instinct, but he says, do it with gentleness and reverence. So that soapbox preacher on the corner just yelling at you, that's not what Jesus wants from you. That's not what Jesus is calling you to do. That's not the kind of witness he wants you to be. So we do it because he told us. The second reason we do it is because it empowers our relationship with Christ. It empowers our relationship with Christ. Jesus said, wherever two or more gathered, I'm in the midst. And I can't tell you the number of times I've been with somebody and they share with something to me that God has done for them, and I share something that God has done for me, and they share something that God has done for them, and I share something God has done for me. It's like that song about Jacob's ladder. It says, every round goes higher, higher. So as we sit there, we can feel the Spirit of God building up as we just talk about what God has done. That's what that witnessing is, and it draws Christ into our midst, and he magnifies himself in our presence. And the third reason to witness is because it inspires others. It inspires others. We used to have testimonies in church growing up.
Yes.
You know, now it's reserved for watch night service and Ash Wednesday service. We'll get somebody to give a testimony. But you know, a testimony is so powerful because when I see how God has worked in your life, then I think that God can do it in my life.
Right.
When I hear God saved you through cancer, I know he can save me through cancer. When I hear God brought your son home, I know he can bring my son home.
Right.
When I know that God took you off of drugs and alcohol, I know he can take me off of drugs and alcohol. So our testimonies are powerful because it shows the power of God. But two things we need to understand is that the power of the witnessing is not in us. It's the power of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is the power behind witnessing. It's not us. The other thing we need to know is that God is already going before you to prepare the ground. Does that mean everybody's going to hear what you say? No. But the ones who God means it for, they will receive it, but you've got to speak it. So, there are three things we need to do to witness, and then we're going to get out of here. Three things you need to do to witness. The first is that you need to have an experience with God. Let me say that again. You need to have an experience with God. If you never had an experience with God, then you probably don't have anything to share. If you never had an experience with God, you might not even be a Christian. I know you've been going to church all your life, but there's nothing that you can say in your life that's unmistakably, undeniably God, then something's wrong. And I look for you to give me a call. Let's talk about it. Let me help you to see God in your life. You see, I'm not asking you to quote scripture. Anybody can quote verses, but our stories are what's powerful. Our stories are what sticks. That's why a witness tells what they have seen, what they have heard, and what they experienced. I can remember the first time that I experienced God, I was 5 years old. My family had gone to Washington, D.C. to visit relatives, and it was 4th of July weekend, and on the 4th of July, we were at the Washington Monument. And at this time, they put all these different vendors around the Washington Monument, and all four sides look the same if you don't know anything else. So my brother and I and some of my cousins had gone, I don't know if it was popcorn or for cotton candy, but we had gone to get something, and we were walking around, and all of a sudden, my cousins who were from the area were gone, and it was just me and my brother. And we were lost. We didn't know what to do. We walked around that monument one more time, and before I knew it, my brother was gone. And I was by myself, 5 years old. And I walked around about two more times around the monument. Every side looked the same. I didn't know which way to go. But I remember something that my grandfather, the Reverend C.S. Stinson, said to me. He said, God is always with you. And when you need him, all you have to do is stop and talk to him. So this little five-year-old boy stopped, bowed his head, closed his eyes, and said, oh, Lord, please help me find my way. And I opened my eyes. And I turned and walked directly to the exit that led me to my family. You have to have an experience with God. But that leads me to the second thing. You have to recognize God's acts. You have to recognize God's acts. We're too quick to call something a coincidence or a luck. You can say, yeah, that little boy, that was just a coincidence that you saw the exit after you prayed. No, there was no coincidence to that. I prayed and God answered my prayers. We need to be intentional about looking at the acts of God in our lives and in the lives of others. When we ever close meetings and people ask me to pray, I say, tell me your praise reports. Give me your praise report. Tell me what God has done in your life. And too often, the only thing people can come up with is, he woke me up this morning. Don't you see, God has done so many other little things. We're looking for big miracles, but God is working in the little miracles, the small things we call coincidence. Somebody told me that coincidences are God's way of remaining anonymous. Mm. You see, I don't believe in luck. I believe that God made it happen. When I was late for one morning for school, and as a matter of fact, one of my members told me that she was in the Twin Towers every day before the bombings occurred, and something happened to her that day that made her late so that she wasn't in the building. And so she is alive today. Now, you could call it happenstance, you could call it coincidence, you could call it nothing, but we just need to call it what it is. That was God protecting her because it wasn't her time, and God still has more for her to do, and she's on fire for God right now. And there are other stories, countless stories that I can tell you about like that, but we call things coincidence or luck. We need to recognize God's acts. So first we need to experience God. Can I get a witness?
Yes.
Then we need to recognize God's acts. Can I get a witness?
Yes.
And then the third thing we need to do, we need to share God.
Yes.
We need to share God. A silent Christian is an oxymoron.
Mm.
A silent Christian is an oxymoron. You know, in both the Upper Room and the Daily Bread today, it talked about people being lonely because nobody's calling. All we have to do is share God. But you see, if you're not excited about your God, why would you expect anybody else to be? If your God is dull and boring, why would anybody care? If your God is weak and omnipotent or impotent, that's not the God you want to share. But if your God can supply all your needs according to his riches and glory, if your God came to earth as a human to give you abundant life, not an abundant death, if your God can do exceedingly and amazingly above all you can ask or even imagine, then you need to share that God with somebody else.
Right.
The same thing with your church. If you're not excited about your church, why should anybody else be? If the worship is dull and boring, don't share that. If your preacher doesn't know the word of God, if you go to church and you don't feel anything but the friendship from the people, that's not something you can share. But if you get fed the word of God, if something inspires you, something that touches your life, something that changes your life, something challenges you to be who you should be in Christ, then you need to share that with somebody else. The only reason I can think of it and not to share God with somebody is if you think God's going to give out of lessons, give out of miracles, and you're not going to get enough. That someone else is going to take your blessing. Don't you know what God has for you? He has for you. All we have to do is share this good God. Share that good news. You see, I'm going to give you an opportunity to do that right now. In the bottom corner of your screen, all you have to do is punch that part that says, that little arrow that says share.
Okay.
You share this message with somebody else. And somebody on your friend is going to watch it. And when they watch it, they're going to either respond to it or they're going to ask you a question, why did you share this? And that will give you an opportunity to share your faith. Tell them what you believe in, why you believe it. You see, it all comes back to your why. It all comes back to your why. Why do you serve Jesus? Why do you call him your Lord and Savior? Why do you call yourself a Christian? We need to tell that story. Can I get a witness? Can I get a witness? Now, some of you may be searching. You've been searching for a while for something that fills you up. But you know there's a God-shaped hole inside you that only God can fill. So if you're lost, we ask you just to say this simple prayer. Lord Jesus, come into my life. I'm a sinner. I ask you to be my Lord and my Savior. I surrender my all to you. If you prayed that prayer, we believe that you have been saved again. We ask that you find a church where you can be taught the word of God, not what people say, not philosophy, but the word of God, because there's power in God's word. That's what we have to save us. And then you can tell somebody else your story. What has God done for you? Thank you so much for coming today. We appreciate you. Remember, you can still give to this ministry five different ways. You can give online at epfmumc.org. You can text to give at 404-567-5052. You can give through the Give Plus app. You can mail a check to the church at 2651 Church Street, East Point, Georgia, 30344. And you can drive by the church and drop it off in our drop box. Thank you for coming this Sunday. Thank you for being a part of this ministry. Now share this so someone else can get this good word. Next Sunday is Pentecost, when the Spirit was given to the church. The Holy Spirit was given to the church. And we're going to celebrate that next week. So come back and join with us at the same time, the church at EPFM. Have a wonderfully blessed day, and know that God loves you.